Some of us are right on point with God. We've got our relationship good, and we're so grateful again. We're so overwhelmed by what He's done for us again. Some of us come in here, I guess, scraping through that front door, thinking, wow, if only people knew what I've been through this week, and yet His grace is sufficient for us. Some are in here and they've absolutely no interest to be in here, been brought in by somebody, trailed along again for yet another week. Yet how wonderful to know that God's grace is extended to you also. That He's no respecter of persons. He's no respecter of situations. He's no respecter of history. He's no respecter of background. His grace is available for every one of us today. And I trust that that grace touches you. I trust that that love gets you just where you are. I trust that His unmerited favor towards you hits you between the eyes today. That something happens and scales come off and you realize that Jesus is alive and He died for you and He was buried for you and He rose again the third day for you. Hallelujah. That's our God. Praise His name. Praise His name. Great stuff. Great to see you today. Thank you, troops. Tremendous. Why don't you smile at somebody, give them a good smile and take a seat. Fantastic. Hallelujah. Tremendous. Great to see you today. If you're a guest or a visiting with us and passing through, then an extra special welcome. We love to praise God. We love to lift up His name. He has done so much for us. He's real in our lives. It's a relationship that is not far away and distant. It's right here, right now, right where we're at. And so as we gather this morning, I guess, no, afternoon now, as we gather together, we're here to, again, just, I guess, endeavor to lay ourselves open to what God wants to do in our lives. You know, I'm so grateful that the Jesus who died on the cross didn't just say, I'm only dying so that you might be saved. I'm only dying that you might just get into heaven. His deal was that He died on Calvary to make you and I free, to make you and I forgiven, but also to make you and I shaped and fashioned into His very likeness. That as we go through this life that He gives us, every week, you know, we come in this door. How grateful are you this week that He's given you the air in your lungs again? He's given you some vim in your, not vim, but what's that? Force and energy in your body to get you here and once again to get you through the doors. He's given you all that stuff. He's given you a mind that works. He's given you a digestion that you love. He's given you lungs to work, legs to work, a brain that receives stuff. How wonderful is our God, all because of His grace, all because He wants another opportunity that we might come under the sound of the Word of God and even again just take a moment where our lives are tweaked and shaped and shifted just that little bit. I think it's amazing. God's got a plan and a purpose, as we say again and again and again, for all of us. He wants to shape you and I. I love it, the fact He doesn't leave us. He doesn't say, that's it, you're saved, I'll just beam me up and off we go. He leaves us here on earth that we might be an influence and a great seasoning of the world that is around us. We're going to start a new series today. Everybody say, new series.
New series. New series.
Whoa, new series. New series. And so we're going to take these next few weeks and we're going to be into Matthew chapter 5 for a few weeks. Just before we start, I just wanted to kind of say to you that actually, you know, this is the 15th year that it's been my privilege to be the pastor here. And I think this week has actually been the hardest week to prepare and get this message organized and ready. Of all the times and of all the Sundays and of all the seasons, this week has been actually the hardest. And I say that, one, that you'll let me off the hook, but two, actually, I think it's stuff that the Lord really wants to say. I think He really wants to convey and communicate stuff, firstly to me, but also to you. Because the things that we're sharing over these next few weeks actually are all of our lives and all of our story. And so I would love us if we could listen in and lean in to what God wants to say. There are so many stories going around in the life of even just this community that are relevant to what God wants to say to us and through us, I think, through His Word. You know, every day you and I are bombarded with so many voices that are trying to communicate stuff and trying to influence you and me and trying to shape our lives, and they're trying to direct where we go and trying to guide us through life, and voices are everywhere trying to get you to do what you're supposed to do and to get you to be who you're supposed to be. And all of us in this room would be aware of so many voices that come. Depending who you're married to, then you've on average got about 30,000 words a day that you listen into. Some maybe more, some maybe less. But the average is 30,000 words that you lead in and listen to on a daily basis. Of the time that you're awake, 55% of that time is taken up listening. But it's a sad truth that you only absorb that which you hear to the tune of 17 to 25%. So for some of you, it's time to get up and go, because you've got everything, you've heard everything you possibly can today, and your 17% is up. I hope that we got over these next half hour or so a little bit more than the 17%, that you can up your input, up your absorption rate of that which God wants to say today, of that which we need to hear today. You know, for all of us, I think we grow up hearing all manner of different kind of voices. There are voices that come into our lives at all times. And throughout our lives, we hear different voices that influence us. When I was a little boy, there were many voices that tried to come into my life and tried to shape my life. Some of these voices, I'm sure you've maybe heard also. There's a voice that says if you sit too close to the TV, it hurts your eyes. Or if you shine a torch under the blankets, it hurts your eyes. Anybody? Yeah, you got those kind of. There's another voice that said to me when I was a young boy, if you swallow that chewing gum, it's going to hurt your intestinal system. Yeah, we get that one. This one, a voice that said, as a little kid, my mom's voice said, don't crush your eyes because they'll get stuck. All of us know this one. The voice that declares and says to us, don't go outside once you've had a shower because wet hair outside will give you a cold. Some of you believe that one. Hey, steady. There was a voice, I guess, if your ears are burning in here at the moment, that voice that said, somebody's talking about you if your ears are burning. Voices that come all the time. Voices that say, if you crack your knuckles, then you're going to get arthritis. Yeah, a lot of you believe that one, yes? Yeah, it's not true. You're okay. You're okay. Trust the doctor. He knows. A voice that, I think this was one of my aunties or something, said to me that if you eat the crust of the bread, then you get curly hair. Yeah, I think it was just a ruse as well. Women, you ladies, you love this one. Never trust a man whose eyebrows meet, as in his heart you'll find deceit. Come on. Never trust a man whose eyebrows meet, because in his heart you'll find deceit. Voices all over the place. Voices all over the place. And if you're between 18 and 24, you're probably already well on the way to getting your average of 128 texts per day. If you're my age, you only get 16, and so far I've only had one. So, hey, make my day and text me and tell me something. Also, if you're 18 to 24, the first voice of the day that you hear every day is probably the voice, if you're 50% of 18 to 24-year-olds, the first voice of the day is the voice of Facebook. That's the thing that wakens you up in the morning, and you switch on Facebook, and that's your first voice of the day. Voices are everywhere. Voices speaking to you and speaking to me, trying to say something to you or sell something to you. Voices that are reminding you, or voices that are recommending things to you. Voices that are conveying things to you, or voices that are trying to counsel you. Voices are everywhere, and you know, the truth is that who we listen to and what we listen to actually can shape our destiny. It's the who we become and the people that we are moving towards is so often shaped by the voices that we hear and the words that are coming into our lives and where we get them from. I believe that God is interested in the voices that we hear, and he's interested in the voices that are coming into your life and to my life. He's interested into where we get our direction of life from. He's interested in where we're taking the wisdom of life from. He's interested in the voices that are coming into our lives. He's interested in how we respond to the voices that are coming into our lives. But he's also interested in the voices that we declare. He's also interested in the voice that you are, and that you are, and that you are, and that I am. The voice that we are to others. What is it that we say to others? What is it that we convey to others? What is it that we are communicating to other people? It's the voice in that we hear, and the voice that we are declaring out. You know, we're going to be looking at Matthew's gospel. Matthew wrote primarily to the Jews. He wanted to say to the Jews in that first century in Palestine, Jesus is the Messiah. and let me gather all these proofs about where he's come from, who what his pedigree is, who he is, what he's done, and what he's going to do, and what he says, so that you might believe that he is indeed the Messiah. And in chapter 5, there's that pivotal verse around verse 14 and 15, where he says to the gathered community that were there, and to you and I up on that hillside, I guess, now if we can metaphorically put ourselves on that hillside with him, he says to you and me, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. You are a city set on a hill. And what he's trying to say is, folks, we are the ones who are carrying the influence to the world that is around us. We are the ones who are carrying that message and that influence to go and make a difference in the world, in the generation where we found ourselves. We're alive in this generation, and he's placed within you and I the message and the life to make a difference. And he's describing there, you know what, to be that salt and light, to be that city on a hill, to be that influential, then you got to have certain attitudes. Attitudes that he said, let me tell you about them. Attitudes that you need to be. And the Sermon on the Mount, as we know it, is that pivotal verse is surrounded by two halves. The first half we've talked about here before. Blessed are those who are humble. Blessed are those who are meek. Blessed are those who are spiritually bankrupt. Blessed are those who are hungering and thirsting after righteousness. Blessed and blessed and blessed. And he describes there some attitudes that people, positive attitudes, that if we get them on board and they're displayed and demonstrated through our lifestyle, then we will indeed be salt and light. If we can gather the, as it were, the Magna Carta of the king, this is what the kingdom is like. If we can imbibe some of the truths that he's trying to say in that first part of Matthew 5, then you and I will live out what it means to be salt and light. But the second half, he also says, but there's actually some negative qualities that I need you to put to the side and embrace some other truth, that also some other attitudes, some other behaviors, some other voices that you need to listen to that will also shape your attitudes so that you may also be salt and light. So come and turn with me to chapter 5 of Matthew this morning, and we'll read verses 21 through to 26. Matthew 5, 21 through 26. He says, you've heard it said to the people long ago, do not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I say to you that anyone who's angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to his brother, Raka, or empty head, or the lights are not on, that was the term it was meant, is answerable to the Sanhedrin. But anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fires of hell. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there you remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Settle matters quickly with your adversary who's taking you to court. Do it while you are still with him on the way, or he may hand you over to the judge, and the judge may hand you over to the officer, and you may be thrown into prison. I tell you the truth, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, but I say to you. On the wall you can see it. You've heard that it was said, but I say unto you. You've heard that it was said. This is what's been said, and this is what you've heard. These are the voices that you've heard from the past, and this is what you've understood them to say. These are the voices, and what are the voices that you and I are listening to? What are the voices that we're going to explore over these next 4 or 5 weeks or so? You know, for all of us, we need to explore again and think again, what voices am I listening to? Where is the source of my information coming, my wisdom coming, the shaping of my life, the directing of my life? What voices am I letting into my life? What messages am I receiving? What person am I becoming? Am I indeed salt and light, a positive influence in the environment around? Or am I actually becoming sand and darkness? Am I actually generating no light whatsoever to the world that is around me? Am I actually not savoring the world at all? Am I just a handful of sand or a handful of salt? Am I generating light or am I generating darkness? And Jesus was talking here, and we're talking today, about the voice of destruction. It's the voice of destruction as he was looking and quoting Exodus chapter 20 and verse 13, which was the sixth commandment. You shall not murder. And he says there, don't participate. You know, he's saying, you've heard that it was said, don't murder. Don't get involved. Don't participate in. Don't be party to. Don't be aligned with somebody who's going to take somebody else's life. Don't get involved in the process that is going to deny somebody their future. Don't get involved in the process that is actually going to take life from somebody. That's what murder is. Murder has all those components in it. It's actually stealing from that which is the present. It takes the value and the worth and the dignity of somebody and takes it away. It steals actually from the future. Once you terminate a life, then there is no legacy that's going to be left by that life. There is no future that that life is going to have. And so by getting involved and being involved in murder, then of course it takes away from the future of that life. It takes away from the present potential of that life to influence anybody around. And that's what murder is. And we're all sitting here today, thankfully, saying, well, that's good, that doesn't involve me. Well, at least I hope it doesn't. You can maybe come and talk to me afterwards, but maybe not. But I don't think it involves anybody. And it didn't involve the Pharisees. And they said, hey, that's okay. We're excluded here. That's not a voice that that voice of destruction is not one that we're listening to. That's not the one that we're involved in. That's not a voice that's influencing us. We're not participating in the voice of destruction. So what voices are we listening to? You see, I think there's several voices that you and I get our lives misaligned by because we listen to them. The first voice is the internal voice of destruction. The internal voice of destruction is my voice that tells me about me. It's my voice that speaks to me. It's self-talk. It's the filter. It's the voice through which I hear any other voice. It's that truth that the truth is the voice that I hear within me is not the voice that is spoken to me. Let me say it again to you. The voice that I hear within me is not the voice that is spoken to me. Let me get an illustration. If I can get Barry and Ryan to help me, that would be fantastic. If Barry, you can be the nice guy as you are in there. And Ryan, you are a nice guy, but you can stand here too. You see, every conversation that you and I have is not actually a conversation. Every conversation is not actually a dialogue, it's a trialogue. Every time you have a conversation with somebody, because somebody will say something to you, but everything that you hear them say is actually filtered and spoken through the voice, the internal voice of destruction that is within you. Now, I'm not unique, and I'm sure all of us have that voice. It's when somebody says to you, you did well. What do you hear that voice say? If you're like me, that voice doesn't often hear you did well because the internal voice here is also speaking into me. That internal voice is also saying to me, if he only knew who you were, he wouldn't say that. If he only realized what you did last night, he wouldn't say that. If he only had been with you last Thursday, he wouldn't say that. He doesn't really know you. He doesn't know what kind of failure you are. He doesn't know what kind of faults you have. He doesn't really kind of know what you really are like inside. And the internal voice of destruction is loud within myself. Am I? Yes? All of us have the internal voice of destruction that is talking all the time. And when somebody is speaking, everything is filtered through that voice in our own lives. Everything is filtered through, so we don't actually hear what is being said. We hear what we perceive as being said. Yes, he doesn't really know me. Yes, he doesn't really mean it because he doesn't know what I'm like. He doesn't know all the faults and the failings that I carry. He doesn't know all the issues that are going on in my world. And the internal voice of destruction is loud in our ears. All of us carry the internal voice of destruction. All of us have that voice that shouts loudly in our ears, that talks to us again and again and again. And even today, when we leave this place and we get involved in conversation, the internal voice of destruction will be whispering all the time, that filtered talk through all of our hearts and through all of our lives. Which voice are you listening to? Are we listening to the internal voice of destruction, or are we listening to the eternal voice of construction? Which voice are we listening to? On the wall there, you can see, you have heard it said, but I say to you. Some of us, you see that you have heard, sorry, let me give a thank you to these boys. That's fine. Thank you. You see, there's two sizes of font here. But you have heard it said is a small font, but I say unto you is a larger font. But we live our lives with that upside down. The I say unto you is a small font, but you have heard it said is the large font. What's the font in your mind? What is the volume of the voice that is in your head? Is it louder from the eternal voice of construction that our God wants to build us and lift us and tell us who we really are? Or is it the small voice that is around and the inner voice of destruction that says, you're not up to it, you can't do it, you're not able, because of your personality, because of your upbringing, because of your background, because of what you don't have, you're not going to be able to be who God thinks you might be. Yes, somebody's maybe stood and you've stood in a line at the front here and somebody's laid their hands on you and they've prayed for you and they've declared some things, but the internal voice of destruction says, there must be the guy next to me that he's praying for. Hello? Somebody has written you a letter and said, you know what, you're just going to be a no. Addressed to the wrong person. Because the internal voice of destruction is so loud in our lives and so loud in our experience. That inside voice of negativity constantly puts to death anything of life. Puts to death anything of life that God wants to create and craft within us. And it constantly shouts loudly for you and for me and says, no, you don't really know him. You know, in this last week and even in the life of this local church, there's been several stories where the internal voice of destruction has been so strong and so loud in the lives of different individuals that it actually has brought them almost to a point of saying life is not worth living. And here we are in here today. And we come in here with the internal voice of destruction still whispering away. Even as I'm talking, your internal voice is filtering all the time. And that's not for me. That's somebody else he must be talking about. Or how does he know my story? How does he know that's for? All of us have got the internal voice at the moment filtering even the conversation that's going on. And it may be that even in this room this morning, there are some that are contemplating, yeah, that's right. That voice is so loud within that my life's not worth living. You see, there was a moment in David's life when it was almost the same. He'd been in battle and he'd been in a great war against the enemy, and the enemy had actually snuck round and come and stolen all the wives and stolen all the families and stolen all the flocks and the herds, and it was a terrible time. And the whole army, he came back to find the whole town had been raided and everything had been lost, and everything that he held dear had been gone. It had been a moment of great grief for the whole nation, that all that they counted dear to them was gone and lost and forever disappeared. And it says that the people there began saying certain things externally. It says David was greatly distressed in 1 Samuel 30, for the people's voice said, stone him, because the soul of all the people was grieved. Every man for his sons and for his daughters. And you would think in that moment, the internal voice within David said, that's it, it's all over, I'm done, I'm a hopeless leader. You may be thinking the internal voice for David would say, these people are right, that I'm useless, I'm hopeless, I can't do anything, I can't lead these people, why am I in charge? I've got nothing, no qualities within that can make it, but the Bible says no. The Bible says, but David encouraged himself in the Lord. You see, he'd gone for vocal tuition classes. He'd gone for teaching classes to train the internal voice that was inside him. All of us sing this morning. Some are fantastic. Some can give it, some can give it, Some are hopeless, some are great. Some of us need training, some of us don't. But in our spiritual internal voice of destruction, all of us could do with vocal coaching. All of us could do with help and assistance to get the internal voice of destruction to shut up. That you and I get a handle and an understanding of who God thinks you are, who God thinks I am. When he looks at you today, he doesn't see somebody who's hopeless. He doesn't see somebody who's worthless. He doesn't see somebody who's got no future. He doesn't see somebody who's got all the brokenness. He sees a whole, perfect, wonderful human being for whom he's crafted and shaped and planned a purpose and a destiny. Friday night, we had the privilege of being out at Casey and Ola's home in Portlethen and the naming ceremony of their little daughter, Ozina. And we were there, and as we usually do, well, he always gives me 35 names to remember. It's always a disaster. But we've got all these names. But it's always prefaced by saying Psalm 139, that the Bible says very clearly, we are all fearfully and wonderfully made. All of us. There's nobody in here that God doesn't know every detail of our lives, whether it is little Ozina who's brand new or whether it's the oldest person in the room. God knows every detail of your life, and he's for you. He's not against you. He has got a plan for you. He sees the brokenness of your life, but he sees beyond the brokenness of your life. And that internal voice of destruction that's shouting loudly within, it's time for that voice to shut up and to align ourselves and to listen to what the voice of Jesus Christ is for you and for me. You see, when we say that the Bible says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, the next phrase is, and that my soul knows very well. We may know that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, but our soul doesn't engage in that process. Our inner person doesn't get a hold of that truth to be able to be the foundation stone on which we stand that says, I am who God has made me to be, and I'm valuable and I'm worthwhile. I'm the apple of his eye. I'm the one that he values so greatly that his very own precious son would come and die on my behalf. That's how much he values us. That's how much he loves us. Put to death and tell that internal voice of destruction to be quiet and to shut up. Which voice are we listening to? There's not only the internal voice of destruction, there's actually the external voice of destruction also. You've always heard that little phrase. It says, sticks and stones will break my bones, but words will never hurt me, huh? How many know that? Balcony never knows anything. They never stick their hand in. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt. What a load of tosh. What a load of rubbish. All of us in this room today, I'm quite sure, have the scars and the wounds and maybe even the active pain from all the hurt and issues that have come through the spoken word landing on you and me, where external voice of destruction has said to you, you're no good, you're no good, you're no good. Whether it's a response to an invitation for a job, whether it's a parent, whether it's a school teacher, whether it's a friend, whether it's a close relative, whatever it is, that external voice of destruction has said to you, you are not who you say you are. You are hopeless or worthless or of no value. Proverbs 18, verses 20, 21 says, words satisfy the mind as much as fruit does the stomach. Good talk is as gratifying as a good harvest. Words kill. Words give life. They're either poison or fruit. You choose. Whoa, you choose. This morning, as we gather together, we need to be aware that we have the choice of either being poison or being fruit. The voice that we declare, the voice that we are, the external voice that we project. What are we this morning? Are we the voice that kills us? Are we the voice that destroys, that steals, that removes vulnerability, that takes down the life that is given? Or are we the voice that produces life around us? You know, so many people, even in the life of the church over all these years, so many people have said, oh, the church is not like what it used to be. The church is this, the church is that. The church doesn't do this, it doesn't do that. It's not friendly anymore, it isn't a family anymore, it doesn't help anymore. I've got a drawer in my office, and in the second little filing area, there's all these letters and all these things that people have written to tell me that from the external voice of destruction how bad things are and how poor things are and how hopeless stuff is. And they're all in there in little letters. Some of them I haven't even opened, hallelujah. I haven't even opened them. But they're all in there because we all are subject to the external voice of destruction. That voice that comes and says, you're worthless, you're hopeless, you aren't who you say you are. And that voice is shouting loudly. But which voice are you listening to? You have heard that it is said, but I say unto you. And what did Jesus say? You see, he said, it's not about the physical act of taking somebody's life. It's not about the physical act of removing somebody's future. There's more to it than that. It's not about the action, it's about the attitude. And he says these three things here that we read together in verse 22. I beg your pardon. Yeah, 22. But I say unto you that if you're angry with your brother, you'll be subject to judgment. If you say to your brother, Raca, then you're going to be before the Sanhedrin. If you say, you fool, you'll be in danger of the fires of hell. You know, he's saying that the voice of destruction starts actually with the attitude of destruction. It starts in our heart, not in our mouth. And he's describing there, he says, it can be because of negativity carried within. If we harbor anger, and that word anger is an interesting word, it's about ongoing resentment and unforgiveness and bitterness. It was a smoldering and not letting go of something. Hebrews 12 says, make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. Where are you in here today? Have you got that root of bitterness slowly growing up and consuming you? Is your attitude one of negativity all the time? Are you carrying and harboring that negativity within? Paul wrote to church in Ephesus and said, put off falsehood, speak truth to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, don't sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger and still while you're still angry, because then you will give the devil a foothold. You know what a foothold is? It's that small little place at the bottom of a climb that allows you to get a start. It allows you to get a start as you're climbing and moving and shaping and heading from where you are to where you're going to be, a foothold. I remember when we used to, well, I've told you this story before, but I love starting fires. I've always liked a fire, a good fire. And we've got this thing in the back garden, which my neighbor has just done the same again. He's made a whole bunch of wood available. And we've got this thing, and I just love chucking wood in this fire and just sitting there and watching a fire. It's a lovely way to pass the time of day. So I love starting fires. But right up the back of the house, we were doing some work, and I cut down some trees and some shrubs and started a fire. And it was fantastic. It was raging for the whole evening. And then it was time to go to bed. I thought, I better put this fire out. So I covered it in earth, and the whole thing was covered in earth. And I thought, that's fine. Went off to bed, slept all fine. Got up the next morning, so I better clean this up. But when I kicked the dust, the fire broke into life again, and it just needed a little bit of oxygen, and off it went again. You see, the fire was like this. It was harboring all that energy inside, all that harm and destruction. It was harboring and containing and smoldering underneath. It didn't need much oxygen. It didn't need much air. But once it got a little something, it came alive again. Is that you today? Are you harboring and carrying within you that negativity? Because if you're carrying negativity within, he says it's not difficult to move from the negativity within to be the negativity that's communicated about. It's not just holding in our head, but it's the hurting with our tongue. You know that story, if you sow a thought, you reap a statement. If you sow a statement, you reap an action. If you sow an action, you reap a habit. If you sow a habit, you reap a lifestyle. If you sow a lifestyle, you reap a destiny. It all begins with the thought that you're sowing and the voice that you're speaking. And he says here, if anyone says to his brother, Raca, it's an Aramaic word, it actually meant, you know, that you're useless, you're hopeless, you can't do anything, you're incompetent, your capacity is poor, you're not the same as me. What are we saying about people? What is the voice that we carry about people? Are we the voice of destruction or are we the voice of construction? What are you known as? Are you known as the voice of negativity? Are you known as the voice of cynicism? Are you known as the voice of no, it can't be? Or are you known as the voice that yes, it can be? Moves from the negativity carried within to the negativity communicated about, but also it changes and ends. He says, but anyone who says you fool will be in danger of the fires of hell. You fool is about value and worth. It's about character. It's about the devaluing of a person. And he's saying there, if you're going to confer your negativity upon anyone, then you're in danger of the fires of hell. What's he saying there? He's saying that actually the external voice of destruction that we have the ability to choose to be or not to be, to say or not to say, is so important because it eventually comes to the value of people. And Jesus, you see, he's already said to you and me the value that he places upon us. In Romans, Craig already quoted that sometimes Jesus demonstrated, sometimes people will die for somebody else, but Jesus died even when we'd no interest. The Bible says, you see it just at the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. What's that statement saying? He's saying that sometimes people are of so much value that you could actually consider, you know what? That might be life for life. That might be a decent exchange. He has done so much for society and for the world. Actually, I could give my life for him. But when Jesus looks at you and me, even though we're sitting here today, still far away from him, still not interested in him, still got no sense of what he's done for us, yet he values you and I so much that Jesus came and did a John 3:16 for you and me. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son for you and for me. How wonderful is our God today that that's how much he values you. That's how much he concerned. He's concerned about you. You know, there's that L'Oreal advert on the TV. It says all these ladies buy this stuff and put it on because you're worth it. Yes? Yeah. You do know what I'm talking about, yes? Yeah. You're worth it. I would say to you today that God says to each one of us, you're worth it. You knew it was godly ladies, didn't you? But he says, you're worth it. You're worth it. Every one of us in this room today, you're worth it. Tell your neighbor, you're worth it. Tell the person sitting next to you, you're worth it. 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 God is willing. God considers your value to be so great. He says you're worth it to the degree that he sent his one and only son, his most valuable and precious commodity, that he might say to you, this is my voice. The world may say to you, you've heard it said, you're useless, you're worthless. You've heard it said that you'll never amount to anything. You've heard it said that destruction is your outcome. You've heard it said that life needs to be taken from you. You've heard it said that there is no future. You've heard it said that you're never going to influence anybody. But I say to you, you're worth it. This morning, as we close and we finish up and the band come up, you know, what is the voice that you're listening to today? Where are the voices coming from? Are you listening to the internal voice of destruction that describes who you are and what you are and what you're going to be? Are you listening to the external voice of destruction? What about us as a local church? What are we conveying today? Are we conveying that external voice of destruction to other people? To people within this community? What are you saying to other people? What is the words that are going around all over the place? Are you carrying that negativity that then comes to the place of communicating that negativity? To even conveying and conferring that negativity? Where are we today? Are we the bearers of the voice of destruction? Are we listening to the voice of destruction? Are we becoming the voice of destruction? You've heard it as said, but I say unto you today, God is looking for you and I to shift and to change and to become the men and women that he wants us to be. Enlarge the font of his voice in your life. Reduce the font of the other voices in your life today. Let's bow our heads just for a moment this morning.